We're going to take the opportunity in this chapter to introduce the first of those 11 organ systems. We're going to take a look at the integumentary system. This is the system that includes the skin on the surface of the body. It also includes a few other things. In addition to the skin, we also have the hair, the nails, and a number of glands that exist. And all put together, this makes up the integumentary system. So let me go ahead and put down a picture. This is showing a cross section through the skin, and we can see there's a lot of complexity actually if we look just beneath the surface. So we've got a blood flow, blood supply. We have a hair shaft that goes down here, and there is a gland that that secretes. And over here is a sweat gland. This one is secreting sweat all the way up to the surface. So all of this put together is comprising the integumentary system. What does this system do? Why is it important? So we already know a little bit about it. It provides protection. It protects our bodies from abrasions, but it does a lot of other things too. It actually provides to some degree waterproofing, so it helps prevent our bodies from becoming dehydrated. Water is not able to just leave the body. Rather, there's this barrier that keeps it inside. The skin also provides a lot of defenses against pathogens. So even if there is, for example, a scrape in the skin, there's a good immune presence right here in the skin. A lot of immune cells hang out in the skin and provide a good defense against pathogens that might try to enter the body. The skin has an important role in synthesizing vitamin D, and vitamin D in turn is very important for our bodies to be able to use calcium to build our skeletons correctly. So that's definitely an important role. One other thing that the skin provides for us is a lot of sensory input. There are a lot of sensation receptors that are present in the skin. This allows us to feel things through touch. We can feel temperature. We can feel pain through the integumentary system. So it does a lot of different things. Let's go ahead and take a look at some of these detailed layers that are involved. We can see labeled over here, we've got an epidermis, and then we have a dermis beneath it. And beneath that is a hypodermis. So let's go ahead and take a look. We're going to focus in on the epidermis and the dermis and see what's going on in those two locations. Okay, so the epidermis of the skin, this is the very topmost layer. This is what you see when you look at your skin. You're looking at the epidermis, and this is a layer that does not have a blood supply. There are no blood vessels present. And so consequently, these cells are not living. Okay, so it's the very outer surface is a layer of dead cells, dead skin cells. And then if we go a little bit deeper beneath that dead layer, we have a living layer. And there are two cell types that are present here. There are the keratinocytes. These are the cells that produce a lot of keratin protein. And that keratin protein provides some waterproofing. So these cells, these are keratinocytes. And as they age, they get pushed upwards. Essentially what's happening is the cells down lower are dividing, and so they push these other cells upwards, and eventually the cells die and end up in this dead layer of epidermis. Okay, so the keratinocytes provide the keratin that gives some waterproofing up in this layer. The other cell type that's present are the melanocytes. And these are the cells that produce melanin. This provides our skin with some pigment. Everybody has the same number of melanocytes, roughly, and keratinocytes. But the amount of melanin that they produce and how long that melanin lasts, that can end up influencing skin pigmentation. So all of this is taking place in the epidermis. This is the top layer of the skin. And you'll see labeled right here is a basement membrane. We saw that earlier when we learned about epithelial tissues. We said they are anchored by a basement membrane to whatever is beneath them. So what is beneath in this case? We have the dermis. The dermis is the other layer of the skin. And the dermis does have a blood supply. So consequently, it's nurturing living cells. And mostly the dermis is made up of connective tissue. Okay, so connective tissue versus epithelial tissue up above. Primarily, what type of connective tissue? Primarily, this has dense connective tissue, so we've got a lot of collagen fibers, also elastic fibers and reticular fibers. All right, skin does have some elasticity, that's very important. And all put together, this the dermis essentially provides the ability to stretch and also have some strength. Skin does have some strength to it. The cell types that are present in the dermis primarily are the fibroblasts. These are the cells that are producing these special fibers that are needed. There are other cells present also, but I chose to just have us focus on the fibroblasts. Those are the ones that are primarily giving the characteristics of skin. In addition to these cells that we have mentioned, cells and fibers, we also have what are called accessory structures, and that includes the things like the hair, the smooth muscle that's lining the blood vessels, the sebaceous glands. These are oil glands that they produce oil, which helps to moisturize the skin, the sweat glands, which are very important in thermoregulation, controlling temperature. We'll see that in just a minute. We've got blood vessels present, and we also have nerve endings, sensory nerve endings that allow us to detect sensations through the skin.